Hi everyone, I'm Trish Connor Cato. Welcome to the Access 2021 video course. This video course is for beginners in Microsoft Access, all the way through experienced everyday users looking to sharpen their skills and increase efficiency in Access. Access is Microsoft's relational database application used to organize and store data. Access also has reporting capabilities. So what's covered in this course? Our advanced training starts with advanced report and form design techniques. We'll then learn how to create switchboards, write macros, and use Access Visual Basic for applications for complex automation. We'll end the course by covering database security and customization options. And along the way, I will point out features that are new to this version of Access. If you're enjoying these videos, please like and subscribe. If you have any questions you want answered by one of our instructors, please join our off-site community. The link is in the description as well. As always, if this course has exercise files, you'll find them in the video description below. Welcome to Module 5. This is our next to the last module. In this module, we're going to be covering advanced form design techniques and automation. So we have our lessons listed here, starting with advanced form design techniques. Then we're going to be using switchboards to navigate database objects. The automation piece is designing macros to automate database tasks and an introduction to Access Visual Basic for complex automation. Now we're going to get started with advanced form design techniques, and that's going to include us creating subforms, tabbed forms, and split forms. You'll get explanations of all of those three types before we begin creating them. Our first lesson, advanced form design techniques, we're going to create three different types of complex forms. We're going to start with a subform. A subform is literally a form within a form. When you change the record on the main form, the subform will update with related records. So we're going to start this by creating two separate forms. We're going to do the first one by using the form wizard. So we're going to go to the Create tab and access the form wizard. And we want to base this form off of the orders table. So I'm going to make sure I find the table and not the query because I want all of the fields from the table on this form. So I'm going to just use the double arrow to move all of the fields over. And I'm going to choose next, leave it on that layout, next again. And we're going to name this. I'm just going to select everything there. We're going to name this form FRM. Orders and items. And we're going to click finish. So right now it's just showing orders, even though we named it FRM orders and items. And this is going to be known as our main form. So let's go ahead and we'll fix the label up at the top of the form later, but let's go ahead and close the form. And we're going to create our other form, our subform or child form. So our main form is FRM orders and items, and its child form, which is the subform, we're going to create in form design view. So go ahead and go to create form design. And if your field list is not open on the right side, you can use the add existing fields button on the form design tab of the ribbon to get it to show. And we want this to be created off of the order details table. So in the field list, I'm going to expand the order details table. I'm going to right click on order ID and add field to view. Product ID, same thing. And quantity. So I'm just going to add those to the view. I can go to form view to take a look at it, and that's fine. And then I'm going to save the form, and it's going to be FRM order items. FRM order items. And click OK. And you can close that form. So we've created two forms. Our main or parent form is orders and items, and our child or sub form is order items. Let's open the main form, orders and items, in design view. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to expand the detail section. So I'm going to put my mouse between the end of the detail section and the top of the form footer section. I'm going to click and hold and drag down about that much to create more space in the detail section. Actually, going to give it just a little bit more space. So in order to embed, if you will, the subform into the main form here, we're going to use the subform subreport control. But before we do that, I want to make sure that a setting is active. If you look up at the form design tab of the ribbon in that controls group where we got a label from earlier, we're going to do the more button. That's the down arrow on the right side of it with the line above it. And we want to make sure that use control wizards is active. Let me just explain this a little bit. If it's not active, I just clicked on it to deactivate it. It won't have the shading. If it is active, the little wizard wand will be shaded. And you want to make sure that that is active. If you don't, it's going to expect you to program everything that you do. We want the wizard to guide us through the programming steps at this point. So we want to make sure that's active. Now that the controls gallery is exposed, the subform subreport control is the third one in the last row. So you can do a subreport using the same control if you were in a report design view. We're doing a subform. So we're going to select that control. When we move our mouse around, it looks like a plus sign with that control attached to it. And if you just watch my screen, I'm going to click and hold right about here, drag to the right, and then drag down so it's showing a box about that size. Now notice at the top of the box there's a label and it says child 9. The subform is the child form. It'll give it some random number. And because our wizard controls are activated, the wizard pops up. So lesson within a lesson. If you drag a control to an object and the wizard doesn't pop up, you delete that control off of the object. You go and activate it from the more button, the wizard controls, and then you do it all over again and you'll get the wizard to pop up. So it wants to know, it tells you, you can use an existing form to create your subform or create your own using tables and queries. We want to use an existing form, and our child form is FRM order items, and we're going to do next. So would you like to define which fields link your main form to the subform yourself or choose from the list below? The list is pretty good. So I typically use the list unless I can't use the list. So what this is saying in the list is, show SQL statement for each record in table orders using order ID. And so we're basing this, we're saying we're using the order ID field to kind of bind these two forms together. So we're going to make sure that show statement is selected and we're going to choose next. Now we could name, it's going to use the same name that the subform is from, so order items, and we're fine with that because that's just going to be a label that we're going to delete. So we're going to click on finish. And notice right above your subform, you have that label FRM order items. You're going to just select it. When it has the yellow band around it, you're going to press delete on your keyboard to get rid of it. And now we can look at this in form view and test it. So let's go to form view. And so whatever order ID is in the top record, right, in the main form, it's showing the order items in the subform. So if I go to the bottom to my record navigator and I switch to the next record in the main form, notice that the subform is updating as well. So it will always be matching the order ID and showing the product. That is an example of a form within a form known as a subform. Now I just scroll down a little bit. I'm on record 10 in the main form. And if I look at, there's another record navigation within the subform. So it's telling me for that customer ID Bearcat boosters on that particular order date, there's actually two different products down there. So I can scroll between the two products. If I go to the next record on the main form, that also has two products. So I can scroll through them in the subform. And we can go ahead and close that form. Well, actually say no, cancel the closing the form. We want to go to, let's just go to layout view and we'll change the label there. We'll get rid of FRM and just put a space between the words. And now we're ready to save it and close it. The next type of complex form we're going to design is known as a tabbed form. A tab form has multiple pages, if you will. So if you have a lot of data, a lot of different fields in your data, you might want to split those fields up across different pages. And that's what we're going to do right now. We're going to go back to form design. So create form design. And this is all about a control. So if your field list is open, that's great. We're going to be utilizing it momentarily. If it's not open, you can open it by doing add existing fields. To create a tab form, you're going to use the control that looks like a file folder with tabs on the side of it. It's called the tab control. It's in the first row of your controls group. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on that tabbed control. My mouse now looks like a plus sign with a folder attached. I'm going to go pretty much in the upper corner of the details section, not all the way in the upper corner, but close. And I'm just going to drag across and down until almost the entire details section is filled. And then I'm going to let go. And you'll notice that it gave me a form framework with two pages. That's how it defaults. In your field list, expand the customers table. And so far we've been right clicking on fields and adding fields to view. For some reason, when you're doing a tab control, it doesn't really like that too much. So here we're going to drag and drop the fields. And remember, you don't want to drag them all the way to the left because you have to leave room for the label. So I'm going to drag the company name field. When you're on top of the form, it will turn black. And I'm not going to go too far to the left. I'm going to just drop it right about here. So I left room for the label. We're going to drag address 1 under company name. And we'll get these aligned after we get them all on the form. Go ahead and drag city over under address 1. And we're going to grab state. And so all of these fields are going on page 1, right? That's the page we were on. We're also going to grab the zip field, put it under state. And we'll add the phone field here as well under zip. So now to align these things, we're going to start by aligning the labels to their left edge. So it will align them to the leftmost label. So what I'm going to do to select all the labels, I'm going to click and hold little bit above and to the left, of the company name label, and I'm going to just drag down until the other labels are selected. I'm going to go to the Arrange tab on the ribbon. To the right in the Sizing and Ordering group, I'm going to choose Align and then Left. So now all the labels are aligned by the left edge. I'm going to then drag a selection net around the fields. It's called a selection net, selection marquee, a lasso. I've heard it called a lot of different things. And we're also going to align them by their left edges. And now we want to make sure these are all vertically spaced equally. So I want to drag a selection net around the labels and the fields. And this time, in the sizing and ordering group, I'm going to choose the size space dropdown. And in the spacing section, I'm going to choose equal vertical. And then click away from them so they all have equal distance between them vertically. So that's just page one. Now we're going to get ready to do page two. So we're simply going to click on the page two tab. Make sure it has that yellow border around the entire page. And now we're going to add a couple of fields here. We're going to drag the email field onto page two. And again, leave room for the label. And we're going to drag the active field underneath the email field. And so we don't have to align the labels because the active field, well, that's weird. The active field label came up over here. Move that. We are going to have to align the labels. Yeah, my active field label came up on top of the checkbox. So I'm going to just drag a selection net around both labels and try really hard not to move the page framework. And I'm going to align them by their left. I'll do the same thing with the fields. And then I'm going to select the labels and the fields. And in my case, the page again, because I can't seem to help myself. And I'm going to do the size space equal vertical. Now, I don't like where it moved the label for the checkbox. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just manually move that one down a little bit. I don't like the way where it put it. So now we have our tabbed form, and we can take a look at it in form view. So you can see the fields we have on page one and on page two. Now go back to page one and take it to layout view for a moment. We need the company name field to be wider, so we can do that in layout view, which gives you the benefit of seeing the underlying data. And then let's go back to design view. It would be helpful to rename the pages. Page one and page two are not good names for these. We want them to kind of indicate what kind of data is on each page. So what we're going to do is go ahead and close our field list in on the right side and go to the Form Design tab and in the Tools group, bring up the property sheet. And we're going to click on the page one tab. So in the property sheet, I can go to other tab or the all tab, and the first property is the name property. So for the page one name, we're going to change it from page one. You can just select page one there, and we're going to type customer info and press enter. So I typed it in plain English. And then I'm going to click on the page two tab. I can get to it right. And I'm keeping an eye on that property sheet. So I make sure when I get it, it says the name property. And I'm just going to name page two status. The next thing we want to do is have a form header section so we can put a label with the name of the form in it. So I'm going to just right click on the gray detail bar and choose form header. Well, actually, we'll do form header footer. And I'm going to expand the form header section just a little bit. I'm going to grab that label control, the second one, the AA, capital A, small a. I always want to use the text box control for the label, but it's not. It's a text box. And then I'm going to just draw a label box in the form header section. And in it, I'm going to type customer information form. And just click away from it. And now you can go look at your form and form view again so you can see that you have that form header section. Let's go back to design view one more time for this one, our tabbed form. And if you right click on any page tab, you can see where you can insert or delete pages. You can change the page order. Let's say we want its status to be the first page. If you click on page order, we're not going to actually change it, but you could move down on customer info or click on status and move up. I'm going to just cancel out of there. So when you're working in here, don't be afraid to click around and look at different things. You have a layout option. It's not letting me select anything, but you can get to align and size and some of these things from the right-click shortcut menu as well. And we're going to go ahead and save this form now. And we're going to name it FRM Customer Information. And click OK. And then we can close it. So far, we've designed two different types of complex forms, a subform and a tabbed form. Now we're going to create our third complex form. And this is probably the easiest one to create. So this one, what we're going to do first is we're going to just click on FRM products in your navigation pane. We're not going to double click it or open it. We just want it selected. And then we're going to go to the Create tab. And in the Forms group, we're going to do the More Forms dropdown. And we're going to select Split Form. And it automatically does it. So we can go ahead and close the property sheet on the right side. It puts it in layout view. So a split form is a form that shows as a form on its upper half and as a data sheet on its lower half. So on the upper half, you're looking at this FLDGRN product ID. And on the lower half, it has that selected. So this is in layout view. Let's do some changes here. Let's get rid of this little logo. And notice that it named it FRM Products 1 because we already have a products form and you can't have the same name for more than one object in Access. So when we get ready to save it, we'll change the name of it. But right now we're going to change this label and we're going to call it Products Split Form in plain English. Product Split Form. And now let's change it to form view. And we can use our navigation buttons at the bottom. I click on the top half first just to make it active window. And then I'm going to go to the next record. So it switches to the vanilla folders up top and it has that highlighted on the bottom. Conversely, if I select a record on the bottom, it will actually bring up that record in the form view on the top. So that is a split form. You just have the form that you want to base it off of selected in the navigation pane. And then you go to create. And in the forms group, you're going to go to the more dropdown and choose split. Now we're ready to save it. And we're just going to give it a name, FRM Products Split. and do okay, and we can close it. Our second lesson here is creating keystrokeless field controls. Basically, these are controls that lend themselves to efficiency. So we're going to deal with default values and tab order. Imagine, if you will, that you've been tasked with entering like 150 orders for a particular date. We'll say like 6/14/2010. And instead of having to type in the order date all the time, you can set a default value on a field. And I'm going to show you how we do that now. We're going to open the orders and items table in design view. And this is our main form and our subform. And what we're going to do is we're going to select the order date field on the main form. Now, if your property sheet is not open on the right side, go ahead and open it by using property sheet in the tools group. And when you're on the property sheet, you want to do the drop down. Now, typically in Access, when you click on a field, it automatically selects that field in the property sheet. Sometimes it doesn't. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the drop down and I'm going to make sure I'm on that order date field. I actually want it to say order date from that drop down. And then I can do this on the data tab. There's a default value property and I'm going to type 6/14/2010. And then I'm going to tab out of that field and notice it puts the pound signs around the date. So dates have to have pound signs around them. And again, Access is very helpful with those formats when you get out of the field. So we're going to see what this does for us. We're not going to save it yet. Let's just go to form view and notice you're not seeing that date here. So this is, you're looking at a current record. If we wanted to enter a bunch of orders for 6/14/2010, if you go down and you do your new record button, and that's the one that has the right pointing arrow with the asterisk next to it. So if you go and you click the new record button, every new record will come up with that order date already populated, which lends itself to efficiency. Again, if you had to enter 100 orders that occurred on June 14th, that saves you time by not having to type in that date. And you can always override it if you need to. I'm going to do the previous record arrow so it doesn't have that new record kind of hanging out there anymore. And I'm going to go ahead and save this form. For adjusting the tab order, we're going to have to mess up the tab order first so that we can then learn how to fix it. So what I'm going to do is, and I'll explain it in just a moment, let's open the customers form in design view. And on the form design tab in the tools group, we're going to click on tab order. And we're going to just mess something up real quick and we'll fix it. So what we're going to do is we're going to click on the row header in front of state on under custom order. And then we're going to click and hold the row header. And we're going to drag state up so it's in between company name and address 1. And now click OK at the bottom. And go to form view. So let's do a new record. And notice when you press your tab key, it goes right to the state field. When you press tab again, then it's on address 1. Sometimes when you create a form and you start moving your fields around on the form, the tab order gets messed up. And for me, this is literally one of my biggest pet peeves. If I'm online and I am shopping for items and I get to the cart and I have to put in my information, if the tab order is not right and I have to keep using my mouse to click in the right field, I will totally cancel out of the order because I know how easy it is to fix things like that, and it just annoys me. So we didn't have any instances of where the tab order was not right, so we had to make it not right so you could learn how to fix it. Let's go back to design view. And we're going to go back to tab order. Now, if it's out of whack, a lot of times Access can fix it for you. And when it's out of whack, it's like usually really out of whack. Like it would go from state to active and then back to phone, stuff like that. So down in the bottom right corner, I'm going to click on auto order. And notice that it puts state right back under city. Like I said, auto order usually works. If that didn't work and you had to click and drag, you know how to do that because we broke the tab order before we could learn how to fix it. So now we're going to do okay. We'll go back to form view. We'll bring up a new record screen. And as we tab down, you'll notice that it's tabbing and it's hitting all the fields in the right order. And we can go ahead and close that form and go ahead and save your changes. Now we're going to add a button control to a form. This is where it gets really cool. This is where I nerd out on you a little bit. Let's open the customer information form in design view. And right on the customer info page, we're going to add the button control. In your controls group, the button control is right to the right of your label control. So it looks like the box. You're going to go ahead and click it. And of course, your mouse pointer changes to a plus sign with a box attached to it. When you hover over the form page, it turns black. And I'm going to just click and hold, and I'm going to draw a box about that big. And because our command wizards are enabled, it brings up the command button wizard. So you have different actions that you can do for each category. So it's on record navigation. You could do find next, find a record, go to first, go to last, go to next, go to previous record. You have record operations, add a new record, delete, duplicate a record, print, save, and undo. You have form operations, which I'm going to skip for right now. These are report operators, so we're not in a report, we're in a form. You have application where it can actually exit from Access. And you have miscellaneous, which is running macros, queries, printing a table, auto dialer if you're hooked up to some kind of phone system, that kind of thing. We're going to go to form operations and we're going to choose close form under action. And we're going to do next. And so you can use text or pictures here. It is even more pictures, but I'm kind of fond of the exit doorway. So I'm going to leave it on that picture and do next. Now, you might end up referring to this button in some kind of code. So it's a good habit, and then you may not, but it's a good habit to get into in naming these things appropriately. The 3-character prefix for a command button, it's actually known as a command button, is CMD, and then I'm going to just do close, CMD close, and finish. So let's save our form and then go to form view, and you should see your little exit doorway button. And when you click it, it will close your form. The last type of specialized form we're going to create is known as a switchboard. A switchboard can be thought of as menus, but it's used to navigate database objects. It's really kind of cool. Now, in order to create a switchboard, you have to use the switchboard manager, which does not show up in Access by default. So we need to add it to our quick access toolbar. Now on my screen, I have my quick access toolbar underneath the ribbon. Yours might be above the ribbon, but wherever it is, what you're going to do is you're going to click the drop down arrow to the right of the quick access toolbar. And almost at the bottom of that list, you're going to select more commands. So now you're in the customize the quick access toolbar option screen. On the left side, it defaults to popular commands. We're going to do the drop down where it says popular commands, and we're going to choose commands not in the ribbon. And then I'm going to just scroll down, or you can click once anywhere in the left-hand list and type the letter S. It only allows for a one-character scroll, so now it scrolled to the S portion of the list, and I'm going to continue to scroll down until I see Switchboard Manager. Now, on the right side, these are the items that are on my Quick Access Toolbar. I'm going to click on Redo, the last item first, and then on the left side, I'm going to just double-click Switchboard Manager, so it ends up being the last thing on my Quick Access Toolbar. And I'm going to do OK at the bottom. Now, if you hover over that last icon on your Quick Access Toolbar, it says Switchboard Manager. Now that we have access to Switchboard Manager, we can create one or many switchboards in Access. Once you put it on your Quick Access Toolbar, it will be there until you remove it from your Quick Access Toolbar. So I'm going to go ahead and click on Switchboard Manager. Oops, I kind of double clicked on it. Let me do that again. And you might get a message that pops up that says it can't find any switchboards, and that's fine. And then if you click OK on that, it will bring you into Switchboard Manager. So when you're in here, it gives you a main switchboard as a default. And I want to point out something. In your Forms group, you have that main switchboard. It's just named Switchboard. Switchboard is a specialty type of form. So we can create a new switchboard or we can modify the main one. We're only going to have one in here, so we're going to just modify the main switchboard by clicking the Edit button on the right-hand side. And you'll notice it says there are no items on this switchboard. So on the right-hand side, we're going to click New. And we're going to go to the Command drop-down first. And we're going to choose Open Form in Add Mode. And then we're going to change the text to say Add New Product. And then the form, we're going to do the drop down, and we're going to select our product split form. And we're going to click OK. So we have one item on the switchboard so far. Let's do a new item, another new item on the switchboard. And this one will start with the text. We're going to choose Add New Customer. The command is going to be Open Form in Add Mode. And that form is going to be the customer's form. And we're going to do OK. We're going to add another item, new item. And this one is going to be, let me see which command I want to use here. Okay. We're going to say the text is going to be View Customer Information Report. The command is going to be Open Report. And the report is going to be RPT Customer Information. And we're going to do OK. And that's enough for our switchboard right now, right? So we can go ahead and close out of there. And so what does that do for you? Okay, I'm going to show you what it does for you. Open your switchboard form, the form that's called switchboard. So this is the main switchboard. I mean, we could change the name of that. If you click on Add New Product, it opens the product split form and it's ready for a new record. Notice that the switchboard form stays open. So I'm going to go back to switchboard and I'm going to choose Add New Customer. So the customer form opens ready to add a record. I'm going to go back to switchboard and view customer information report. So the switchboard allows you to easily navigate through different database objects. Now I'm going to close all the tabs except the switchboard tab. Actually, I'm going to just close everything. And then I'm going to double click the switchboard again. And I am going to go to layout view. And in layout view, it lets me change that label. So instead of main switchboard, I'm going to just call it, I'm just going blank here. So I'm just going to call it Trish switchboard because I can't think of anything better in this moment. So that's how you build a switchboard. Now let's close that switchboard and say yes to save the changes. And we're going to go back into Switchboard Manager. So we have our main switchboard selected. We're going to edit it on the right. And we're going to click New on the right. And my next command that I'm going to add, just go to the command dropdown and choose Exit Application. And the text is going to be Close Database. And click OK. And then close that Edit Switchboard page and close the Switchboard Manager. And now double click your switchboard form. And you'll notice you have the Close Database on there now. And you can actually click that and it will close that database. So now we're getting ready to get into designing macros to automate database tasks. In this lesson, we're going to create a macro that will close or open database objects. We're going to use message boxes to notify users. We're going to automate parameter queries with macros, view related records in another form with macros, hide and unhide field controls with macros, and we're going to use macros to validate data entry. Back over in Access, I'm going to reopen my customer orders database, and we're going to create an auto exec macro. So we saw an example of an auto exec macro in the Northwind database. An auto exec macro is the one that when you open the database, the macro executes or runs. So in the Northwind database, when we opened the database, the first thing that popped up was the login form. That was the result of the auto exec macro. You can only have one auto exec macro in a database, and it has to be named auto exec. So we're not going to use the MCR prefix for this one like you normally would for a macro. It just can be named auto exec. And we're going to build it so it opens our switchboard for us, our switchboard form. So we're going to go to the Create tab, and all the way to the right in the Macros and Code group, you're going to click on Macro, and it just gives you this one box. And if you do the drop down, you'll see a list of actions. And the action that we want is Open Form. So once you click that, it gives you more fields that you may or may not need to fill in. You definitely need to tell it what form to open. So we're going to do the drop down to the right of form name field, and we want it to open the switchboard. And we're going to open it in form view. We don't need to put in any filters or where conditions or the data mode, and we're going to leave the window mode as normal. So all we have to do now is name this macro auto exec. So I'm going to right click on the macro one tab and save. And it needs to be capital A, auto, capital E, exec. So it stands for automatically execute. So automatically execute this macro when the database opens. And the macro is telling it to display this form. We're going to click OK. And we're going to close the macro. Now, a couple of things, if you scroll down in your navigation pane, you now have a macros group and you have your one macro there and just notice its icon. Now to test this, we have to close our database and reopen it. So I'm going to go to File, Close, And then I'm going to go back to file and click on customer orders. And there you have it. When this database opens now, auto exec kicks in and it displays the switchboard. You can go ahead and close the switchboard. The next macro we're going to create is going to display a message box for the user when they open a particular form. So we're going to go ahead back to create macro. And we're going to use the same action that we used before. So we're going to do the drop down and select open form. And this time the form we want to open is the customer information form. We'll open it in form view. We don't have to do anything else on this screen. And now what we want to do is add another new action. So we're going to go to the secondary add new action dropdown. And we're going to look through this list of actions to find the message box action. So for the message box, the message is what displays for the user. So what we're going to type here is please check to see if customer exists before creating a new record. That's the polite message to the user. We're going to have the message box beep. So we're going to leave that yes. When the message box is displayed, it'll beep. For the type, let's do the drop down. And so you have critical, warning with a question mark, warning with an exclamation point, and information. We're going to do information. And the title that shows in the title bar of the message box is going to be please check customer. And I'm going to do an exclamation point. So we're going to save this macro. And we're going to use the MCR prefix for it because it's not an auto exec. And we'll just call it check customer. And click OK. And we can run the macro from the macro design tab of the ribbon. The first button is run. So notice it opened the customer information form and it's displaying the message. So there's our title bar. It's an information. So you got the eye icon and then the actual message. So we'll click OK. And we can actually use our close button to close that form, and we can close the macro. Now we're going to create a macro that's going to automate parameter queries. So we're going to start this in the order summary report. So what we're going to do is right click on it and open that report in design view. Now, the first thing we need to do in here is disable our control wizards. So we're going to go to the More button to the right of the Controls gallery, and we're going to click on Use Control Wizards to disable it. And now we're going to grab the button control, one that looks like a rectangle, and we're going to draw a button on the right side of the report header. And it can be just about that big. Now in your property sheet, if it's not open, go ahead and open your property sheet. You want to make sure it says command 15 here to mimic that command button. If you need to, you can select it from the drop-down list. And we're going to go to the all tab in the property list. So we're going to name this button and we're going to name it CMD open query. So CMD is the 3-character command button prefix, CMD open query. And then we're going to use the caption property right under the name property. The caption is the text that actually shows up on the button itself. So our caption is just going to be in plain English. It's going to be open query. And you can see that appear on the button. And now we're going to go to the event tab on the property sheet. So we want to create a macro that executes when that button is clicked. So we're going to use the onClick event. All the way to the right side of it, you're going to click the ellipsis button, and you're going to, and Macro Builder is already selected. You're going to go ahead and click OK. So we're going to use the open query action here. So go ahead and do the drop down and find the open query action. And we're going to use the drop down to the right of query name, and we're going to select orders by date query. So we're in the order summary report, and the orders by date query is the query where we set up parameters for the start and end dates. The next macro I'm going to challenge you to create on your own. It's going to be used to view related records in another form with macros. So we're going to have a command button in a form that will open another form when it's clicked. So you're going to place the command button in the orders and items form, and you're going to use a macro, an embedded macro, to have it open the products form when it's clicked. So again, you're going to create a command button in the orders and items form, name and caption it accordingly, and then attach it to the onClick, attach the macro builder to the onClick event of that button, and have it open the form products. And to test it, you should be in form view on the orders and items form, and you can click your view products button, and it should open the products form for you. Now we're going to create a macro that will hide or unhide field controls based on the value of another field. So in our situation, let's do this. Let's open up our customers table. And you'll notice that we have some inactive customers that have an employee assigned to them. And so if the customer is inactive, we're not going to want to see the employee field on the form at all. So we can go ahead and close the customers table. And we're going to go down to our forms area, and we're going to open the customer information form in design view. And we're going to go to the status tab. We're going to want to add another field, the employee field, on the status tab. So my property sheet is open currently. I'm going to just go click add existing fields to get my field list. And I'm going to drag my employee field onto the status page of the form, making sure I leave room for the label. And now what I'm going to do is go ahead and save the form and go to form view and click on the status tab. So if we navigate to record number 6, I'm just using the record navigation area, we'll see that we have an inactive customer and the employee field is showing there. So we're going to build a macro so that if the customer is inactive, then the employee field will not show on the status page of the form. So let's go back to design view. In design view, we're going to click to select the active checkbox, not its label, the actual checkbox. And we're going to bring up our property sheet. So if you're not on the event tab, go ahead and click the, well, actually, before we even make sure which tab we're on, we want to make sure that it's on that active checkbox, right? So I'm going to go look through these things and I'm going to select active, right? And then I'm going to go to the onClick event ellipsis and get back into Macro Builder. So for this macro, we're going to use an if-then statement. So from the action dropdown, you're going to select if. Notice it gives you the if. Over to the right, there's your then. And then underneath it, you have end if. You can add else or else ifs if you have multiple criteria. We only have one. So in the if box, we're going to type an open square bracket, and we're going to start typing active. And notice it shows on the list and it lets you know it's a checkbox. I can double click it and it will finish putting it in as well as the closing square bracket. After the closing square bracket, I'm going to type an equal sign and type the word false. And now we're going to add a new action right underneath the if block, not after end if. We're going to add a new action, and you're going to do the drop down and you're going to look for an action called set value, and you're not going to find it. So all of the available actions do not show in this drop down unless you tell it to show all of the available actions in the drop down. And so if you look up at the macro design tab at a ribbon, in the show hide group, you're going to click on show all actions. And you notice that that show all actions button has a warning symbol in it. So these types of actions don't show by default. They could be actions that impact your data, stuff like that. So if you need them, you need to know how to access them by clicking that show all actions button. Now, when you go to add new action dropdown underneath the if statement, you will see set value in that list. And it gives you the warning symbol because it's saying, hey, listen, this could change some stuff in your data. So it has two arguments, the item and the expression. And for item, we're going to do a open square bracket and we're going to start typing employee. It shows up on the list. It's a combo box and we're going to just double click it to get it in there. So the item to set value is employee, the employee field. And after the closing bracket, we're going to type a period, a dot, and start typing visible. And visible will show up on the list and you can double click it. And then for the expression, we're going to type in no, and then I'm going to explain it. So it looks like the opposite of what we're trying to do. We're saying if active is false, then set the value of the employee to the opposite of visible. So make it invisible is what it's saying. So we're going to go ahead and save and close this macro, and then we're going to test this. So take your form to form view, and we're going to use the record navigator until we get to record number 6. And then we're going to go to the status page. We have an inactive customer and it's showing the employee. So if I check and uncheck active, then you'll notice that the employee field disappears. And that's how that works. It's hiding and unhiding depending on the status of another field. And we can save this form and go ahead and close it. The last macro we're going to build is going to be used to validate data entry on a form. So I'll explain it as we go. We're going to open the customer information form in design view. And you want to make sure your property sheet is open on the right. On the property sheet, you want to make sure your selection type is set to form. And on the event tab, we're going to go to the before update event. So the before update event, you know, as you tab through a form, if you're doing data entry, once you're in the last field on the form and you tab again, it's going to want to save what you did and give you a new form for data entry. So before update means before the form data is saved, run this macro. So we're going to go over to the ellipsis for the before update event and go into our macro builder. And for this macro, to validate data entry, we're going to use another if action. So I'm going to select if, and you're going to type the word is, and you'll see a list of different functions show up. We want to double click is null, which means it's empty. And then it gives us an open parenthesis. We're going to start typing city, and you'll see the field name on the list, and you can double click it. So it puts it in square brackets, and we're going to do a closing parenthesis. So right now it's saying if the city field is empty on the form, that's all we have so far. So if the city field is empty, we're going to add a new action right under if, and we're going to choose cancel event. So if the city field is empty, do not save the information that was put on the form. That's where we are. We're going to do another action right under cancel event. So if the city field is empty, it's not going to update the data on the form, but we would like it to display a message box for the user. So we're going to select the message box action again. And the message is going to be the city field is required. The type, we're going to do the warning with the exclamation point. And the title is going to be missing required information for the title bar. So, okay, if the city field is empty, it's not going to update the data on the form, and it's going to display a message box for the user instead. We're going to add one more action, and this is a really good one to think about when you're in a situation like this. So we're telling the user that the city field is required. They're not going to be able to continue until they get that information in. It would be nice to put their insertion point in the city field. So we're going to add another new action right under message box. And that action is called go to control. And the control name, we're going to start typing city, and the field will show up and you can double click it. So if they're putting in a new record on the customer information form and they skip the city field, it's going to display a message box letting them know that the city field is required, and it's going to put their insertion point in the city field. That's how that one's going to work. So now what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and save and close, and we're going to test it. So let's go to form view and do your new record button at the bottom. And for a company name, we'll just put ABC. The address is going to be 132 Main Street. We're going to purposely skip the city field. We'll put in a California as the state, 95814 as the zip code. And I'm just going to use a phone number of 555-777-7777. And now I'm going to press my tab key. So because we have a button, it's going to go to the button. And then I'm going to press tab again. So now I get my message box, right, with the title bar, missing required information. I have my warning symbol with the exclamation point, the actual message, the city field is required. I'm going to click OK on that message, and notice my insertion point is in the city field because of the go to control. So I'm going to just type Sacramento in there, and I can tab through again past the button, and now it will update that by saving that information and giving me a new blank record. And so we can go ahead and close this form, say yes to saving any changes. Our last lesson in this module is an introduction to Visual Basic for complex automation. So Visual Basic for application is built into all of the Office products, including Access. So in this lesson, we're going to use VBA, Visual Basic for Applications, to secure forms with passwords, to create user input boxes, and to use logic programming to interpret conditions. There's a file in the video description called, it's a text document called VBA Code for Access 2021. You want to go ahead and grab that text document and open it, maybe in Notepad or something. The first thing we're going to do in Access is we're going to use Visual Basic to secure forms with passwords. So you should have that document open, that text document open with all the Visual Basic code in it. And we're going to do this on the employee's form. So unless people have the password, they won't be able to open the form. So we're going to open the employee's form in Design View. In the property sheet, we want to make sure the selection type is form. And we're on the event tab, and we're going to go to the ellipsis to the right of the onload event. So when the form is loaded into the computer's memory, that's the onload event. And we're going to go ahead and do the ellipsis, and we're going to go into Code Builder this time. So it takes you into Microsoft Visual Basic for Applications. And this interface hasn't changed in years. It doesn't have the ribbon interface. It has toolbars and it has, it has a menu bar and it has a couple of different toolbars. So this screen doesn't change. It looks the same if you're accessing it from Excel, Word, so on and so forth. So what we're going to do in here, it creates what's known as a sub procedure. It starts with private sub and it ends with the end sub statement. And because we did it on the onload event, right, the name of the sub is form underscore load. So I'm going to press enter just to get a blank line between private and where we're going to paste in the code. And so we want to go over to that VBA code for access in Notepad. So I'm going to just bring that up on my screen. So I'm looking at that Notepad document and I have the code blocks separated by these equal signs. So this first block of code, let me just explain the two lines, the first two lines. Those are comments, meaning they're just used to describe what the code is going to do, right? So we're going to select from the first line all the way down to the end if statement above the equal signs. And we're going to copy that. I'm going to minimize Notepad and I'm going to just paste that right here. So you'll notice that the comment lines turn green. So those lines don't execute. So I have comments throughout this code to try to explain what the code is going to do to password protect a form and that it's used on the form's onload event. So it's declaring a variable. Variable is a temporary space in your computer's memory and it's called passwd. And it's going to create an input box that says enter password. And the title bar of the input box is going to say restricted form. After that, I have more notes. Check to see if there's any entry made to the input box or cancel button is pressed. If no entry is made, then exit this sub procedure. So if the password is empty or if the password is like blank or a space or something, or the password is empty, then the message box will say no input provided. It'll have an information icon and its title bar will say required data and it will exit the sub procedure. If the correct password is entered, it's going to open the employee's form. If the incorrect password is entered, it's going to give a message and exit the sub procedure. So if the password equals learn it with an exclamation point, then it's going to do a command that's going to open the form, the employee's form, and it's going to be opened in normal view. Or else you're going to get a message box saying, sorry, you do not have access to this form. and it's going to have an OK button in the message box, and its title bar is going to say important information. So that's our first block of code. Now, what we want to do is we want to go up to the toolbar and save. And once we save, we can just go up to the upper X in the upper right hand corner and close the Visual Basic window. Notice the onload event now says in event procedure before you've seen embedded macro. So an event procedure is your actual VBA code. Let's save our form and close it. And now we're ready to test it. So double click your employee's form to open it. You should get the restricted form message box and the enter password message. And we're going to just type 123 as our password, which is the wrong password. And we're going to click OK. So we get that important information message box. Sorry, you do not have access to this form. And we're going to click OK. Now we're going to put in the correct password. So double click your form again. And it's capital L, learn it, exclamation point. And when you click OK now, you don't get a message. It opens the form. So we can go ahead and close that employee's form. So now we're going to create a user message box, basically, via a form. So what we're going to do first is let's go to Notepad and bring up that code. And the second block of code to create user input boxes used on onload event, we're going to select that and copy it. And then we can minimize Notepad. We're going to go to the Create tab. And we're in the Forms group, we're going to choose Blank Form. And let's put it into Design View. We're going to open the Properties window so we can go to the Form Design tab of the ribbon and get our property sheet open. And we're not really going to put anything on this form. In the Property sheet on the Event tab, we're going to go to the Onload event and do the ellipses and double click Code Builder. So it gave us another sub procedure. I'm going to press enter and then I'm going to paste the code in. So what's going to happen is it's declaring a variable called username. And then username is going to be whatever the end user puts in an input box. The input box prompt is going to say enter your first name and its title bar is going to say your name question mark. After they put their name in the input box, a message box will pop up with a concatenated phrase. It's going to say, welcome, whatever the username is, with an exclamation point. Let's go ahead and save. And we're going to call this form FRM welcome. And we're going to click OK. And now we can close Visual Basic for Applications. And we can save and close the welcome form. So now we're going to test it. Let's double click the welcome form. You get the input box that says your name question mark in the title bar and enter your first name as the message. And I'm going to just type in my first name and press enter. And now it gives me a pop-up that says, welcome, Trish. That's all it does. And we're going to click OK. And we can close that welcome form. So for the next one, let's go to Notepad first. And we're going to copy the first block of code that says code to use logic programming to interpret one condition. Go ahead and copy that code. And then we can minimize Notepad. So what we're going to do is we're going to do this on the customer information form, and I'll describe it as we go. So let's open that form in Design View, and we're going to select the state field. Now make sure your property sheet is open and the state field is in the selection type dropdown on the property sheet. We want to be on the event tab, and we're going to click in the before update event, go over to the ellipsis, and double click code builder. So it gives us a private sub procedure, and it's based on the state field changing. So when the state field changes, it's going to do this code. And so we're going to press enter and then paste in our code. So what this code is going to do, if the state changes to Oregon, then the back color is going to change. And this color is like an aqua color. If the state doesn't change to Oregon or it changes to a different state, then the back color is going to be like a yellowish color. So that's what we're supposed to be seeing when this works. So let's go and save on the toolbar up there. And then we're going to close Visual Basic for Applications. Save your form. And then switch to Form View. In Form View, on the first record, I'm going to change the state to OR. And you notice that it gets that color, right? So it changed the detail background color when I changed the state to Oregon. Let's close the form and go back over to your notepad. And the next block of code we're going to copy is the code to use logic programming to interpret multiple conditions. So we have a specific back color for Oregon. We have a specific back color for California. And we have another color for all other states here. So we're going to copy that, minimize your notepad. Actually, you can go ahead and close your notepad at this point. We're going to open customer information form again in design view. Click on the state field and go to your before update event. Now, when you click in there, go to the drop down arrow and select event procedure and then click on the ellipsis. And it will take you into that event that we just did to interpret one condition. We're going to select everything except the private sub and the in sub statement. And we're going to do Control V to paste in the new code. We're going to save, close Visual Basic for Applications window, save your form, and go to Form View. Change the first record back to California, and you notice it's getting this bluish color. Let's go to the second record and change the second record to Oregon, and it gets a different color. Let's go to the third record and change that to Illinois. So yet another color. That is how you use logic programming to interpret a single condition or multiple conditions. We can go ahead and close our customer information form. And just to review what we've covered in Module 5, we started with advanced form design techniques where we designed complex forms. We created a subform, so we had a main form and a nested subform. We also created a tabbed form and a split form. After that, we went into creating keystrokeless field controls. So we set default value in a default value in a field. And we also broke and then fixed the tab order on a form. We also added a button to a form for navigation. And then we went on to create a switchboard to navigate database objects. We then moved into designing macros to automate database tasks. So we created macros to open and close database objects. We created a macro that used a message box to inform users. We did another one that automated parameter queries, another that let us view related records in another form. We used a macro to hide and unhide field controls based on the value in a different field. And we also created macros to validate data entry. After that, we got into using Access Visual Basic for applications for more complex automation. So we used Visual Basic to secure a form with a password. We created user input boxes, so like a welcome form, a blank form with a welcome message for a user. And we used logic programming to interpret one condition as well as to interpret multiple conditions. Our sixth and final module in this video course is all about database security and database options. So we have two main lessons in this module. You're going to be linking tables to ensure database security and customizing database options. You'll be using the linked table manager. And so depending on the version of Access that you've had previously, the linked table manager may work differently now. In Microsoft 365 Access, you can use this dialog box to refresh, relink, add, edit, search, and delete linked tables, but you cannot export information to Excel. In Access 2016 and later, the dialog box is much simpler, but you can export information to Excel. So it just depends on what version of Access you're in. Once your database is pretty much built out, you might want to consider whether everybody's going to have access to your tables. Again, the tables are the only thing that holds the data in the database. So most database administrators don't want everybody to have access to the tables. And so what you can do to bypass that is you can place your tables in a separate database, but there's a link to them in this database. So how do we do that? Let's go to the Database Tools tab of the ribbon. And in the Move Data group, you're going to click on Access Database. And it opens the database splitter. It says, this wizard moves tables from your current database to a new back-end database. In multi-user environments, this reduces network traffic and allows continuous front-end development without affecting data or interrupting users. If your database is protected with a password, so the new back-end database would be created without a password and it would be accessible to all users. You'll need to add a password to the back-end database after it is split. So this is the deal. The back-end database, okay, will only contain your tables. The front-end database will have all the other objects, and it will look like the users will be able to access the tables from in there because there'll be links, but they won't be able to do it. So we create this by splitting the database. We're going to go ahead and click the Split Database button, and it's going to open on your system, and you can navigate to wherever you want to put this, you know, the back end. Now notice the file name. It's the name of your database, _BE for back end, right? So it's creating the back end database, which will contain just the table objects. So I'm going to navigate to where I want to put that back end database. And I'm going to just stick it in this directory and click the split button. So it lets me know that it's successfully split and I'm going to do okay. So now we're in the front end database. And notice the icon for the tables, right? Has like a little plus sign on it. And if you hover over any table, it's going to show you the path to the back end database that was just created when we split our database. So if I were an end user and I'm sitting in the front end, I'm going to go ahead and open the employees table in design view. And it lets me know that it's a linked table whose design can't be modified. So if you want to add or remove fields or change their properties or data types, you must do so in the source database, which is the back end. So we're going to say, yes, we want to open it anyway. It looks like we can get in here and do some stuff, right? I'm going to just close the property sheet on the right. But if I change anything in here, like if I try to change last name to long text and I go to close the table, it's going to ask me if I want to save the changes. I'm going to say yes. And it's going to say it can't save the changes for linked tables. And I'm going to just say, no, I don't want to continue. So I'm going to close this table. I'm going to say, no, I don't want to save the changes, but it will mislead an end user into thinking they can change something. And then they get stopped with that message. No, you cannot, right? So your tables are managed in the back end database. And in there is where the people who are going to be utilizing the tables, maybe adding information, creating more tables, that kind of stuff in the back end. And so now we're going to go to the file tab and close this database. And then we're going to open our customer orders underscore BE database. So I'm going to go back to file open. I'm going to browse. And there's my customer orders underscore BE. I'm going to enable content. And you notice the only thing that's in the back end are the tables. So a link to the tables is in the front end, but you can only impact the tables from the back end. We can go ahead and close the back end database and reopen our regular customer orders front end database. And you can go ahead and close the switchboard. So when we split our database, creating the back end, it knows where that back end database is saved. It knows where we put it on our computer. So if we were to move it somewhere, we would have to update the links using the link table manager. So I am just going to go ahead and minimize access. And I save the back end in this folder on my desktop. So go to wherever you saved the back end database and open that directory. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the back end, the customer orders back end, and I'm going to just move it onto my desktop. So I changed its location. And now I'm going to go back and restore my access window. And in my front end, I'm going to double click the categories table. And it's letting me know that it could not find the file because we moved it. So I'm going to do okay. Now I could move it back, but maybe there's a business reason why I needed to move it to a different directory. In order to update the link to where it resides now, we need to go to the external data tab of the ribbon. And in the import and link group is where you'll find your linked table manager. Go ahead and open it. So notice we have our data source name, the data source information, and it's showing where the back end database was before we moved it. So I'm going to select that. And on the right side, I'm going to do edit. So now I need to tell it where it is, right? So the data source name, I could do it this way. Now, there's an easy way to get the full path and everything. So I'm going to just leave this box open. And I'm going to go back to my directory where I can see my desktop here, because that's where I moved it to. So let me bring that window up. So I'm on my desktop directory. And what I'm going to do is I am going to hold down the shift key on my keyboard and right click on customer orders underscore BE. And by doing that, I can let go of shift now. It gives me the copy as path option because I held down the shift key before right-clicking on it. So I'm going to choose copy as path. And now I can minimize that screen. Now in this file name box, I'm going to select everything by like double clicking in there. And then I'm going to do control V to paste that path in. And then the only thing I have to do is get rid of the double quotes at the beginning of the path and at the end of the path. So when you copy as path, it includes the name of the file and its full path to it. So now I'm going to do save. So now I update it where the back-end database is, and I can close the link table manager. And now if I try to open the categories table, it will let me open it in datasheet view. But now I have access to it again because now it knows where the back end is. Now we're going to move into some database options that you should be aware of. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to go to the File tab. And all the way at the bottom on the left, we're going to click on Options. And we want to focus on the current database options. Although I will say to you, in any of the Office programs that you're working in, you do want to become familiar with all of their options. So I'm going to just drag the screen down a little bit. You know, the thing in Access is if you look all the way at the top of the screen, right? The title bar is just, it has the whole path to where the database is and all of that stuff. And it tells you, I mean, they haven't updated this. They haven't updated it for 2019 or 2021, but they all say Access 2007 through 2016 file format. That's a lot of stuff to have in the title bar. So we're going to change that. The first option under application options is the application title. And we just want it to say customer orders database. That's all we want it to say. Now, the next option there is the application icon. We're not going to do it. It's so tiny, it's not even worth doing it. Now, when we open this database, we had that auto exec that's showing macro that's making the switchboard show, right? From the auto exec macro. If we didn't have an auto exec macro, we can tell it to display a form when the database opens. So in the Northwind database, the auto exec macro told it to display the login form whenever the database was opened. And then subsequent to that, it displayed a form called home. So let's do this. For our display form dropdown, choose FRM welcome. Now, we came in here before and we changed it to overlapping windows so we could see, compare stuff side to side. So you've already used that option before, right? Okay. So now that we changed the application title and the display form, I'm going to move my screen back up so I can see the OK at the bottom. I'm going to go ahead and click OK. And it's going to tell me that I have to close and reopen the database for the options to take effect. So I'm going to click OK. I'm going to go to File, Close, and then back to File and reopen customer orders. So the first thing that happens now is it's given me that welcome form, right? So I'm going to put in my name. Oops. And trust me, I do know how to spell my name. And click OK. And it's going to say, welcome, Trish. And I'm going to click OK. And now it does the auto exec macro, which displays the switchboard. And if you look up at your title bar, it simply says customer orders database. It doesn't have that long path to where it resides and all the file formats and stuff. We're going to right click on switchboard and choose close all. So now I'm sitting, I went to the file tab and I'm sitting on the info tab. And the reason why I'm here is because I want to talk to you about when you would need to compact and repair your database. We have a very small database in terms of the data that's stored in the tables. It's very minimal. So you're not going to have a problem with a really small database. But occasionally, if you have a lot of tables that are jam-packed with a bunch of data, you may experience some issues. I mean, you'll know when it's happening. Like if you go to run a query and it hesitates even slightly, that can lead you to know that you may need to compact and repair your database. Now, I had an issue when I tried this a few moments ago. So my information is going to be a little bit different than yours. So the first thing we're going to do on the info tab is go over to the right and click view and edit database properties. And if you're on the general tab, you'll see the size of your database. Now, yours probably says something like 5.12 megabytes. Yours is going to be larger than mine right now. I'm going to just click OK. And I'm going to click on compact and repair database. So it literally kind of does it that quickly. It relaunches it. It's asking me for my first name. It's going to give me my welcome. It's going to open a switchboard. I'm going to close both of those. And now if you go back to file info and you go and view and edit your database properties, your size of your database should be similar to mine now, 1.116 megabytes. So it compacts the database and it repairs any issues it finds. I'm going to cancel out of there and do the back arrow at the top to get back into my database. Now, this situation I'm going to talk about happens very rarely, almost non-existent nowadays, but I want you to be prepared for it. So once you have your database built out, or even after you just build all your tables, you would want to run a database report. You're going to want to print it out, and you're going to want to stick it in a file cabinet somewhere. In the event that a catastrophic event occurs, that report will be your guide to rebuilding your database. So let's go to the Database Tools tab of the ribbon. And in the Analyze group, you have Database Documenter. Go ahead and click on that. So, typically, when I'm building a database, after I get all of my tables built, I will run the documenter. And notice there's different tabs here. So if I was just doing it for the tables, I would just select all on the tables tab and then run it. But we built out the whole entire database, right? So I'm going to go to all object types tab. And I'm going to select all. So it's getting my tables in there, my queries, my forms, my reports, my macros. If we had modules, they would be showing there. It gives me the properties and the relationships. So every single thing that we've done is on that all object types tab. So I select it all, and now I'm going to click OK. So it generates a pretty massive report, and I'm going to just pause for a moment until I stop. Well, it already stopped hourglassing, so I didn't even have to pause. One way that you can get it to render the report a little bit quicker is if you go down to the navigation pane and click on the last page navigator, and now you'll see in your status bar, it was formatting the page and all of that. So now it's loaded the entire report. I'm going to go back to the first page. And I'm going to just zoom in on the report. So it gives me the path to where the database resides. It's letting me know that it's looking at the switchboard items table. It's giving me its properties, the columns that are in that table, right? I'm going to go to the next page. And it's also giving me any. So here's more of the properties and stuff, right? And each field in the table and what type of data type it is and the field size. Everything you would need to know to be able to rebuild your database. I'm going to just go to another page here where I can find another table. So here's my categories table. Here's all the properties. These are the columns that are in it and their data types and their size and any other properties that we set for the columns. I'm going to just put in like page 150 and go to there and see where that brings me. So now we're looking at forms. So everything about the forms. So I skip by the queries because it's doing them in order. And I'm going to go to the last page again. And then I'm going to go back a couple of pages. Let's see where we are now. Yeah. Nope. Last page. Okay. So here it's showing some of the relationships. It should be showing all of them. That's why I was going back a couple of pages. But it normally shows all of the relationships. Now, this report, I would suggest you run it, print it out, store it in a file cabinet. Because if you have a catastrophic event where everything on your computer is fried, you may not be able to get to the document. Now, what I'm going to show you next, I'm going to just go ahead and close this tab. It says Object Definition. And I'm going to go back to the Database Tools tab. And I'm going to go into the Relationships window. Once I'm in there, I can just generate a relationship report. So in the Tools group, I'm going to click on Relationship Report. And you might have to do page size and everything, you know, change it. I'm going to change it to landscape here. And I might have to reorganize stuff in my relationships window to get it to show. So I'm going to show it's going to take two pages, but I might need a different paper size. But this will help me if I had to rebuild my relationships. All of this is included typically in your entire database report, but I wanted to show you the relationship report separately. So these are things that can help you, if necessary, rebuild your database. I'm going to close the relationship report and not save the changes. And I am going to close the relationships window. So to recap Module 6, Database Security and Database Options, we went into how to split the database so that it created a back end copy of the database that stores just the tables, the only database object that contains your data. And then we moved the location of the back end database and had to use the link table manager in order to be able to get the path to where it currently resided so that the front end would know where the back end is and maintain that link. We went into customizing some database options, so we were able to change the application title bar in that section. And we also used the compact and repair tool, which showed you how it can decrease the size of your database. After that, you learned how to create a database report, which you want to print out and store in a file cabinet, not on your computer, and separate from that, a relationship report. I really want to thank everyone for taking your time to view this video, and I hope that it has been helpful to you. Thank you so much for attending this video course.
Thanks for watching. Don't forget we also offer live classes in office applications, professional development, and private training. Visit learnit.com for more details. Please remember to like and subscribe and let us know your thoughts in the comments. Thank you for choosing Learnit.